So the reason Jesus can only provide eternal life is because Christ is the only one in human history that lived the perfect life that I should have lived, that died the death that I should have died, and that came out of the grave, resurrected eternally.
Now, absolutely. I agree with you 100%. Yet I know what some of our viewers are thinking. And, you know, perhaps Peter, as he was preaching this, made this claim that there is no other name given among men. But did Jesus ever claim to be the only way to heaven?
He sure did. There were numerous occasions where Jesus, for example, in that classic meeting with John, with Nicodemus in John chapter 3, one of the most famous texts in all of the New Testament, John 3, verse 16.
Okay.
And Jesus says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." Then he goes on, "For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He who believes in him," Jesus said, "is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already." So repeatedly, Jesus linked salvation and belief in and acceptance of him.
It's amazing. You know, one of the things that comes to mind, as you're talking about this, you've mentioned salvation several times, and obviously the uniqueness of Jesus is linked to salvation. Now, I know that there's somebody who's listening today that has heard Christians talk about salvation all the time and say things like, "Are you saved? Are you born again? I've been saved by the blood." What do those expressions mean? What does it actually mean to be born again? What does Jesus do for us?
The Bible teaches that God created the world perfectly, and as he did, a fallen angel who had rebelled against God in heaven, whom God had given perfect freedom of choice, led Adam and Eve into sin. They consciously chose to sin. Sin, according to the Bible, is rebellion against God, it's separation from God. Isaiah 59, verse 1 and 2 says, "Behold, your sins have separated you from God." When Adam and Eve sinned, they were separated from God, separated from the source of life, separated from the source of love, separated from the source of joy and peace. As they sinned, and as they were separated from God, they were destined to death. See, there are two powers in the world, the power of love and the power of hate. Hate is self-destruct. Right. Hate leads to separation from God and death. The power of love is the power of life. You look at love and selfishness. Selfishness always leads to self-destruct. Love always leads to building up life and joy and happiness. So when Adam and Eve were separated from God, they were separated from the source of life and love. They had the seeds of death in their body, and there was no possibility that they could live forever. The Bible says the wages of sin, that is the natural result of, the consequence of a life independent and separate from God, is death.
Now that makes sense. If God is the creator and sustainer of all things, and you cut yourself off from that which sustains life, what do you have?
It's like breaking a branch off an apple tree. The branch is not going to live for very long. So we were created to live forever. But that living forever was conditional upon our relationship with God.
Gotcha.
And when Adam and Eve sinned, Jesus and the Father and the councils of eternity said, "We'll not push earth out into space. We will not take earth and quarantine it. We'll not let these beings kill one another." Jesus came forth at that critical moment and he said, "Father, I will come. And I will live the perfect life that Mark Finley should have lived, that Sean should have lived. I'll live the perfect life that John or Mary should have lived. I will live the life they should have lived. I will walk over the same territory. I'll face the same temptations of all humanity." That's why our Savior is near to us. That's why our Savior is like us. He took on human flesh. He faced all the struggles and temptations of human flesh. He defeated Satan in the flesh, and he went to the cross, and he died the death that you should have died and that I should have died. That's why the Bible says in Hebrews 2, verse 9, that he tasted death for every human being. That's why the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 21, "He who knew no sin became sin for us."
Yeah.
So Jesus took all my guilt, all my accusation, all my shame upon the cross and died for me. And I can come to him and say, "Lord, I accept that death in my behalf. You have already wrought out my salvation on the cross, and by faith I accept it."
Now, so Jesus stands unique. I remember, you know, there's a passage where Jesus says, I think it's in the 14th chapter of John, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me."
Right.
Now, here's the question I know a lot of people are asking, and I know they're asking it right now because I've heard it and you've heard it hundreds and hundreds of times. And it's this. Okay, if Jesus is the only way to heaven, what about that bushman living in a remote tribe somewhere off on an island in the Pacific that never heard about Jesus? Where's the fairness of God in excluding him from heaven? He never had a Bible. He never had a missionary arrive. He never heard the truth. What about him?
Sean, you're a Canadian, aren't you?
I'm a Canadian.
Canadians are very creative. Has your government created a coin with only one side?
Well, they're working on it, I think.
We have a dime in America, and it has two sides. Sean, there are two sides to this matter. Now, here's the first side. If you look at Scripture in the book of Romans, particularly, there's no salvation outside of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the only method of salvation. There is no other method of salvation. Buddhism is not a method of salvation. Confucianism is not a method of salvation. Islam is not a method of salvation. You look at Romans 1, without Christ, all the world is lost. Romans 2, without Christ, Jew and Gentile are lost. Romans 3, without Christ, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. They are lost. And then Romans 4, 5, and 6, in Jesus, all are saved. So the one side of the coin is, without Jesus, all are lost. But there is another side of the coin. And the other side of the coin is this: a gracious, merciful, loving God knows the background of every human being. It is not that they are saved through the philosophical systems or religious systems that they're in, but it is possible to be saved in God's kingdom by a Christ that you do not yet know and have not come to comprehend. Now, let me give you two or three passages of Scripture.
You're going to have to back that up.
let me give you two or three passages of Scripture on this. Psalm 87 is a good psalm.
Okay.
And then I want to explain it philosophically to you, but I need to share with you a few things in Scripture.
Sure.
Psalm 87 says, "The Lord will count when he writes up the people. This man was born there."
Now that is very interesting.
Yeah, the Lord counts when he writes up the people in the judgment. This man was born there. So there is an infinite God who understands the circumstances of every life. He understands the opportunities of every life. And salvation is not a geographical accident. It's not merely a geographical accident that you and I were born in a Christian country. Is there salvation outside of Christ? No. But who is saved and who is not saved, we have to leave in the hands of Jesus. Jesus knows their background. He knows their understanding. He knows what they would accept. For example, in the little book of Jude, right before the book of Revelation, there is a marvelous passage of Scripture.
Okay.
And I think it's really important in life that we don't play God.
No, I think that's true. That's true.
We don't become play and say, you know what? You have to recite this particular formula. No. Is Jesus the only method to salvation? Certainly. But does the Bible teach that in his gracious mercy and his incredible love, that there may be some people saved that have never heard his name, that he'll teach it later? That's up to God. And I'm not going to play God and say everybody that doesn't make that confession is absolutely lost. Let God make that decision. Salvation is a gift that he gives, and salvation is in his hands. Jude, for example, it says, verse 22,
okay,
on some having compassion, making a distinction. On some having compassion, making a distinction. Does God sometimes distinguish between people who have not had a geographical opportunity to hear his grace and love? I'm going to leave that with him. I'm not going to play God.